after COVID, about 60% of the people lost their jobs. 20% previously were without jobs. 20% were what we call piece workers, having part-time jobs that lost their jobs, and 20% were in more formal work in the work sector. So when we look at children with disabilities in South Africa, we see that in Africa, they are the most neglected group, according to the African Child Forum. When we also look at our progress in reading and literacy studies, a report that came out in 2016, where about 50 countries are part of this program, where the literacy of the grade four learners are tested. And we see that South Africa actually rated the lowest of these countries. So despite our strong legislative commitment by our government, our resources remain scarce and access to services is limited. And we have many challenges. And I think as in many developing countries, our early childhood intervention starts too late. So what is the situation for people with disabilities? We see that there is a huge unemployment rate. It's only about 1% of our people with disabilities are employed. And we also see that we also have a very high disability rate of between 7.5 and 18% of people living in South Africa have a disability. We also have a very huge unemployment rate. And obviously after COVID, that has escalated. We see that there's between a 28 to a 35% unemployment rate nationally, but under the youth, it's as estimated, that's neurotypical people, of about 50%. We also have a huge poverty problem, and we see that 69 to 78% of people live in poverty. And also that our children with disabilities, 600,000, do not even have access to school. Transport is a huge challenge. There's a lot of stigma. There's a lot of beliefs that if a child with a Down syndrome or a physical disability should get on a taxi, that can be, it's almost like the Down syndrome is contagious. And it also can cause a mother on the taxi to miscarry her baby. So there's also a huge challenge to make use of public transport. Obviously in this area, as you can see in this photograph, there's a big problem with sewerage. There's a big problem with violence and crime. There's a big problem with illegal electrical connections. There's a big problem with having access to drinkable water. So who are we and what is the difference that we are trying to make in these circumstances with all these barriers? We are Close to Good. It is a social enterprise. And our main focus is on recycling. So we use a lot of innovative plans to use recycling. As you can see in the photograph, we recycle clothes from regular schools that we run projects with. And with this recyclables, as well as we also recycle shoes that we shred for certain companies. We collect a lot of recyclables that we can use for toy making. And through this clothes, secondhand clothes project, like you can see some of the ladies in the photograph, we are trying to exit people from poverty through this micro business development, of which we currently have 108 micro businesses. 56 of these mothers are mothers of children with disabilities. And as you can see, we really try and run a holistic program, not just only looking at the child with Down syndrome, but also providing for the parents and making sure that the mothers have an income and that any intervention is sustainable. We also have an inclusive employment setting where we include people with disabilities. We run a big young adult with disability program where we try and find work for them in the open labor market. We have a big a 1-2-3 ECD program where we make toys from recyclables that I'll show you now. We also have disability, the specific resources that we develop, and obviously we do a lot of training. So what are our assets? Our assets are the moms with dreams and skills and abilities, despite many challenges. We see that most of them are single breadwinners. And it also happens that many of the spouse would leave as soon as he finds out that the mom has a child with a disability, especially a child with Down syndrome. So there's lots of superstition, and we have these mothers. We also don't have a supportive environment or community where these mothers can find jobs or even have a place to leave their little one when they go out to find work, hence this program. We have a lot of people with the I can attitude. We have wonderful students, like you can see in the picture at the top. We have 24,000 pairs of denim per year. We have lots of secondhand recycling. We have lots of shoe waste. And obviously, we've got a lot of collaboration partners that we're very grateful for. So one of the projects is our also, besides helping the moms, setting up a business in selling secondhand clothes. Most of that would happen on the street corner. It would happen with a rail or a rug that's thrown on the pavement, and the mom would sell from there. We also try and empower them to sell from their houses. So this is another project where we upcycle denim to empower these moms. We train them and we provide opportunity for them to have a machine at home or set up a center from where they can work. Obviously, we've got lots of denim that's donated. We also then would train them in sewing and upskilling their ability, their skills, and then helping them to buy these products back from them and selling it to in the local market. Another project that we run is our weaving project, where we our young adults would cut up the denim and we would train the moms how to weave with this denim and help them to acquire a weaving frame, the denim, and then obviously the logistic support and the financial management and the mentoring for them. So some of the products they also produce that we help sell is products like our bean bags for children with cerebral palsy, our weighted jackets. These were only delivered this week. Our weighted blankets, and you can see there's also a lot of fidgets on. So just it's also soothing the child and helping the child to be calm, but it also provides some sensory stimulation. In the forefront, you also see some of our other disability-specific tools. And obviously, it's not only for children with Down syndrome, it's for the whole spectrum of children with intellectual disabilities, autism spectrum disorders, or kids with hyperactivity. So the project that we run in Diepsloot is in 148 ECG centers. So an ECG center would typically be a shack school made from corrugated iron, perhaps some bricks, a mud floor. And in some of these centers, there's even 250 children per school. And I would say it's not bigger than 9 meters by 9 meters. So many of these classrooms only have place for the children to sit. There's not much outside play space. And we came up with the idea to make toys from recycling. So you'll see in the forefront, there's some of our toolboxes that we pack 50 activities in, 10 for big motor, 10 for fine motor, 10 for literacy, 10 for numeracy, and 10 perceptual activities. And we've also designed these activities so that it can do more, it has more than one function. It might stimulate concentration, literacy, and some perceptual activity stimulation at the same time. So we train the teachers, like you can see in the forefront. Most of them are unqualified. They have a passion for children. It generates an income for them. And when we go back to the centers, we identify between 2 to 5 children with disabilities in each center. Many of the times, the teachers are not even aware that what the diagnosis of a child might be. So it's between 296 to 740 children that are already included. But when we approach or want to approach a parent, we know we have to be very cautious because there's a lot of superstition and there's lots of still beliefs in witchcraft. So if we mention that the child has a problem or we detect a delay, they would immediately take the child out of the school and put him in another ECD. They believe that they have to go back home and worship the ancestors or pay some contribution so that their child can be healed. Or we see what they call, they send the child back home, meaning that the child would just be left in a rural area with what we call a gogo or the grandmother, and she will have to just cope with the child and the child would not have schooling opportunities. They also refuse operations, for instance, eye operation, heart operations, as they feel it might kill the child. We also see that they hide many of them. And my one friend that's also a therapist in this area was commenting on our census 2022 that's going to take place from March this year, and was saying the problem is those kids are never counted. The family just refuses to even mention that they have a child with a disability. That child will stay in the back room, and the person that comes with the census, it would not even be mentioned to them. We see that the school fees in these under-resourced areas are very low. It is about 350 rands. That's about 23 US dollars or 86 dirhams. A teacher's salary would also be between 67 to 202 US dollars. So there's also a lot of challenges that these teachers do not have money for equipment or training to support their early childhood intervention centers. So how do we go about? As I say, we try and identify the children in the ECD center. We would then empower the teacher and try and get the parents together as well. And I'll also tell you about that. So we try and keep these children included in the schools. I also had a situation last week where a three-year-old with Down syndrome, her name is Blessing, was actually refused entrance into an ECD center. And even the social workers have arrived on the doorstep to discourage the mom to say she's not allowed to put the child in that ECD. She has to take the child to some or other special needs school. And the problem is those schools are also full and not always a good stimulation centers. And we would like our kids with Down syndrome to be included. So then obviously, luckily, I could phone another ECD as we are part of the forum, and they said they would, you know, they are willing to have the child included in their program. So here's some photos of training, like you can see here, some moms or gogos that's being trained on how to run a stimulation program, receive a small stimulation kit. There's also some of the teachers where we teach them to put a sensory overlay in a book to really enhance learning, to draw the child into the learning material. I'm also there on a chair. I think I'm blurring myself at the background with a sensory ring for little ones. Here I also am in a rural area. You can see it's in KwaZulu-Natal where I'm training those ladies how to run a good stimulation program. So when we look at this toy bag for stimulation, we see that we try and stimulate all the senses for the little ones. So these are not the ECD kits that we provide. This is a toy bag that we give out to the mothers. So we would focus on visual, auditory, tactile, olfactory, and all the senses to be included. We focus on cognition, receptive and expressive language, and fine and gross motor development. We also address the disability. We try and address, you know, stigmas, myths, you know, what is the future, what operations can be done. We talk about family routines and what, when, how can the child in a very busy family routine where they have to go fetch water, where they have to wash clothes with the hands, how this routine can be used to also stimulate those little ones. We focus on behavior, toilet training, augmentative and alternative communication, and gestures. We also focus on just having a day program, and then obviously how referrals can be made. So this would also be some of the things we would include in a book. On the left-hand corner, you see a cardboard book with different resources that we use from our recycling, and would then include that. You see Minnie Mouse came off a cap, and she was actually part of counterfeit material, so she had to be, you know, we had to destroy the product so I could use Minnie Mouse for my book. We use make sensory cubes for our littlies, fidget bags like you can see there, that was also counterfeit material. We use old gloves and we put marbles in to really stimulate the children. So here's a typical toy basket that a mom would receive, also with her training. So how do we run this program? We really try and identify the child in the ECD program. We try and support the teacher, train her, upskill her, and see how we can approach this period. Obviously, with a lot of caution, we have to build these parents' trust. They've lived in really detrimental situations. They are very disempowered. They are ostracized by the community. So we really have to try and draw them in to a stimulation program and really try and take hands with them, provide them with a home training kit, run a support group for parents, get these parents on par and included, and also address partner and family challenges. We always do a community map to see where we can refer these children. Africa Tokoen is also a wonderful support for us, and currently we're also training them on a very big inclusive program. They are a big NGO that is in many of our townships. We have an organization, HelpLift, where free medical care is given to children, and then obviously taking hands to special needs schools or schools that would run inclusion. And then also our Down Syndrome Society. I'm just going to show you a video of me working with a little one. This mom came to buy clothes. It's the first time I didn't even know the child was there. The child was on the mom's back. And I said, let's just start with, you know, something. And the mom said, this child is very delayed. He's 19 months old. He's not sitting, he's not moving, he's got cerebral palsy, he's got very poor vision. And I said, let me give him some toys, let's start. So I just started running an initial introduction to stimulation. And you can see he's already starting to explore because she said he loves sound. going to move this on. So I was just trying there a variety of positions. The mom actually came back last month. 2 months later, this video was taken in November. It wasn't a planned session. As I say, it was just spontaneous that we recorded it. And she came to show me that this child is already crawling, that is playing, that is reaching out. And I'm not always sure, is it the hope that there's new hope in the mom's heart, that there's new ideas in her heart, or is it because of the toys that I provide? Thank you for that. Okay, so I'm done.
Oh, thank you very much. Anita, thank you very much. I'm Dr. Ehsan. I'm the one of the team members here in Tehran that are organizing this event. I would like to thank you very much on behalf of my colleagues here in Tehran and sharing your very nice experience. If I may, I would like to ask you to stay with us until the end of the session, that we will have a panel discussion with our other panelists, and we will enjoy your experiences, especially with the Down syndrome patients. Okay.
Yeah, that could be wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Danita.
Okay, so I wanted to thank you, Danita, as well for joining us, and for this was such a beautiful initiative that you're starting, that Close to Good. It was really beautiful. It was really moving. The pictures that you were showing, especially the video that you shared and the video of you engaging with that patient, it was really, really moving. It was really, really beautiful. So thank you. Thank you. Thank you for sharing your experience. Thank you for joining us. And this is really inspiring to see how you empower these mothers, how you empower these families to cope and also to learn to live and to love their child and to live with this disability and have a greater life and have a beautiful life with this. So I thank you. Thank you. And I hope you have amazing success whatever you're doing and wherever you are. And please stay with us till the end of the session to discuss if there are any questions in the chat section. So if you may, I want to go to the next speaker. Before that, I just wanted to mention that this video is actually being streamed live on our YouTube channel, Ptom's Pediatric Webinars, and it can be accessed. The content can be accessed after this session is over, and people and you can and I will write the address in the chat section so that you can write that down and you can have that and share that with other people as well. So I want to go to our next speaker. So our next speaker is going to be dear Nancy Gianni and also dear Sherry. So again, thank you for joining us. Thank you for accepting our invitation. Your smile is infectious, and thank you. And I was doing a little bit of research on the beautiful job that you guys are doing. And actually, I wanted to quote a beautiful sentence that I saw that you wrote as a foreword for a book, Beautiful Souls, I guess. It was really moving for me that it said, you said that actually all of us are one step away from being different or loving someone who is different. It could happen with a simple fall of a bike, the birth of a new baby or grandbaby, or debilitating accident. Differences do not discriminate. They don't care who you are. Differences are the ultimate leveler, and they're seconds away. When you experience that difference in yourself and someone you love, things change drastically, and you'll find yourself yearning for a more accepting world. But what Wave will tell, till then, let's start now. You know, that is why we're having this session. We as pediatricians envision a world in which all people with Down syndrome have the opportunity to enhance their quality of life, realize their life aspirations, and become a valued member of a welcoming society. I can't stress this enough, a welcoming society. And that's what you guys are doing in these beautiful foundations that you're preparing, that you have. You, dear Danita, dear Tahmina, who is going to have the lecture after you guys. So this is really inspiring. And thank you, thank you, thank you. So the stage is yours, and you're muted actually, so. No, I cannot still hear you.
Yeah, there we go. Oh, yay. Oh my gosh, this is so awesome. First of all, thank you so much for putting this together. Like, you know, you are bringing awareness to a population of people who desperately need you. And you know, who do we look up to? Our doctors, our pediatricians. You know, the more information we can give them and the potential and what our children can do, the more they're going to be accepted and embraced in our world. It's such an important piece. And I'm so grateful to all of you. I mean, for everybody who's out there watching this, who took the time to put this on, who sought after people that were doing things in their countries. And I just, kudos to you guys. Thank you so much. We feel so blessed to be here. And we have, you know, we're 100% about that acceptance. I'm so glad that you saw that, every single one of us. And this is what I try to tell people. All of us are 1 second away from being different or loving someone who's different. And you're going to want to live in a world who accepts us all. And that's why it's up to all of us together to create that world. It's not going to happen on its own. We need to do it together. We started an initiative called IAcceptYou.org. And you could just go to IAcceptYou.org. And that's a place where people could sit with their, you could sit with your coworkers, you could sit with your children, you could sit with your grandchildren and take the pledge to be accepting. That's all it is. Be generous, be accepting, be kind. It's a simple thing to do. And then we give all kinds of tools and ideas how you can be accepting in your community, in your country, wherever you are. We have lots of tools, whether it's in the workplace, whether it's in your community or in your school, so, or in your family. I mean, that's where it starts. People aren't born. You know, people aren't born to hate. They're not born to see differences. They're taught that. Those are learned behaviors that are brought on by the way we're segregated and separated from other people. And we need to change that. So thank you so much for bringing the awareness to our kids and our adults today.
Thank you. Thank you, Nancy. You know, the beautiful phrase that you used, it was saying to be acceptable and be kind. You know, it was really you when you talk, your speech and your talk is really inspiring, as all of our other lecturers and all our talkers as guests for today. So thank you. So, and also I would love to thank you, Sherry, for joining us again and for helping us. And I know that you're helping again also as well in the Gigi's Playhouse. And thank you, and I wish you all success and everything that I can wish for you guys, and all the positive energy towards you.
Thank you.
So I just wanted to know that if you want me to share the prepared video that you've sent us, or do you want to give the lecture yourself right now?
I think to share the prepared one is better, and that way I won't go off track and take over the whole thing, because that could be a problem.
And, you know, because when you were speaking, you were so energetic and it was really infectious. So, okay, I will play that.
Oh, awesome. Okay. Yes. Because you know what? Because I want to make sure that all of that is said, that it's in there, because it's so important to our families. And I feel like I don't know why God has made me the mouthpiece here where we are for Down syndrome, but I take it very seriously. And when we get an opportunity to teach and to learn, especially when people are willing to do it and coming to something like this, I want to make sure I get everything in there. So better to get me recorded than
okay. Let's catch you. Yeah, they caught you. Okay. So I will play the video, and awesome. So I prepared an introduction for every lecturer that we have, but dear Sherry had a beautiful introduction for herself and also Nancy. So I will skip that part and just get to the video. So I hope you guys enjoy.
Awesome.
Thank you so much for inviting us to speak today at the 33rd International Congress on Pediatrics.
My name is Sherry Andrus, and I am the National Education Manager at Chi-Chi's Playhouse. I'm proud to introduce Nancy Gianni, the Chief Belief Officer and founder of Gigi's Playhouse Down Syndrome Achievement Centers. Gigi's Playhouse is the only international network of Down Syndrome Achievement Centers providing free, life-changing, therapeutic, and educational programs for all ages. With more than 55 Gigi's Playhouse locations across the US and Mexico, and a demand to open 200 more worldwide, Nancy never slows down. She gave birth to her beautiful daughter, Gigi, in 2002. Her birth ignited an unstoppable force of miracles, hope, and unconditional love that is now changing the lives of hundreds of thousands of people every day. What began as a mother's vision to change perception and maximize her daughter's successes has evolved into a global movement of acceptance for all. It is my distinct pleasure to introduce you to Nancy Gianni.
Hello, my name is Nancy Gianni. I am the founder and chief belief officer at Gigi's Playhouse Down Syndrome Achievement Centers, and of course, the Gigi's mom. I would like to thank the International Congress on Pediatrics and the University of Tehran School of Medicine for inviting us to share our How I Learn presentation. It is such an honor and a privilege to speak with such an amazing international group that is actually taking the time to learn more about our individuals with Down syndrome. I can't tell you how much that means to me as pediatricians of you guys taking that time. Nothing meant more to me than when my doctor came to me and said, I've never had a child with Down syndrome as a patient, but I'm ready to learn with you. What a gift from God. So I'm just honored to be speaking to all of you. Did you know that Gigi's is now serving families in over 70 countries with our free programs? Talk about a COVID silver lining. We feel so blessed to not only have the opportunity to reach so many people with our specialty programs, which are designed specifically for the learner with Down syndrome, but to also spread our message of global acceptance for all. Everyone deserves a chance to learn and thrive in this world. We are so excited to share information with you about teaching individuals with Down syndrome and how important it is to teach people the way that they learn. When you do that, the results are truly incredible. Our Gigi University philosophy of confident you, healthy you, whole you really starts at birth. As you know, individuals with Down syndrome have hypotonia, or low muscle tone. It affects your learning, your moving, and everything you do. From the time they are born, they are constantly teaching their bodies to do the simple things in life that come naturally to most of us. Things like walking, talking, eating, reading, and jumping. Do you know when Gigi learned to walk, she still couldn't jump? Who can't jump? When I see kids on the playground and I see them jumping, I wonder if their parents even understand how lucky they are. Think about that for a minute. Something as simple as jumping, they have to teach their bodies the mechanics of. In Gigi's case, it was her brother and sister teaching her the mechanics. Then, okay, go down and up. And it took her months, but she did it. And they always can with a little extra help. The healthier we are, the more successful we will be in life and in learning. That is the first step to teaching the learner with Down syndrome. Set them up for success and let them own it. I tell all my new parents all the time, the harder we are on our kids, the stronger they will be. Sometimes that is not easy with their adorable little faces and their impeccable manipulation skills. Yes, you know what I'm talking about. And we tend to give in to them. But if we hold firm and give them the time and the tools to do it on their own, we will set them up for remarkable success and consequently a great life. Did you know that in 1983, the average life expectancy for a person with Down syndrome was 25 years old? Today, it is 60. With that being said, the world needs to catch up. It is more important than ever for us to provide them the education they need to be successful. At Gigi's Playhouse, we are committed to serving individuals with Down syndrome from prenatal diagnosis all the way through adulthood. We all know about the tremendous impact early intervention has. The sooner we start teaching our babies with Down syndrome and their families, the stronger they will be. We have classes designed just for babies and their families. LMNOP, which is a speech and communication class. Gigi Fit Infant, which is a physical therapy-based fitness program for our infants to give them that strong core so they can get their breath out so they can speak. Destination discovery and open play is a time for parents to network with each other and learn strategies to help their babies learn and thrive. Everything we do at Gigi's is purposeful and progressive. We are always getting them ready for that next phase in life. So as they grow, we continue to provide the tools and appropriate programs designed to support them throughout every phase of their life. From our infant programming to our school age learner, and then onto our teenage and adult learners, we are always there for our students and building modifications. At the same time, we are always keeping that confident you, healthy, whole you philosophy at the forefront. We know our adults are living longer, but did you know that the leading cause of death for adults with Down syndrome is Alzheimer's? Early onset Alzheimer's typically creeps in around the age of 35 for our kids. We need to counteract that, and the best way to do that is to keep them moving, keep them learning, and keep them healthy. Here comes that GGU philosophy again. We all know if you don't use it, you lose it, especially for individuals with Down syndrome. That is why it is more important than ever for individuals with Down syndrome to use their brains and their bodies and use that confidence to continually build themselves up. When our kids are little, it's easier for us to work with them, make sure they get therapies, do homework, etc. As they get older, it is harder for the parents to keep up for lots of reasons. We are starting a new campaign to help parents and teachers understand how important it is for their kids and students to become independent so they keep moving and working when they are older and that they do it independently. Our approach to teaching at Gigi's Playhouse is simple. We set high expectations and create individual adaptations to help each student achieve their highest potential and move towards independence. We work on purposeful progressions, not developmental milestones, and every win is celebrated. You can find more information about this on our website at gigisplayhouse.org or go to our virtual education platform, Gigi's at Home. Thank you again for allowing us to present to you today. Together, we are truly changing the way the world views Down syndrome and sending a global message of acceptance for all.
Thank you, Nancy. I always learn so much when I hear you talk about our mission to change the way the world views Down syndrome and send a global message of acceptance for all. Our next guest is none other than the one and only, the Gigi, Gigi Gianni.
Hi, my name is Gigi Gianni, and I have Down syndrome. Sometimes people ask me what that means. It means I have extra chromosome. I have low muscle tone. This means that things that come naturally to most of you. I have to change my body to do. Sometimes it takes me longer to learn, but I can work extra hard and I can read, do math I graduated from high school. I still learn every day, don't you? Some people think because I have Down syndrome, I do not want to do what others do, and I am not given the same chances. With the help from people and companies like you, we can change that. It will be awesome for all of us. Everyone wants to have friends and acceptance, but can you believe there are still people that think Down syndrome is bad? Join the hashtag Generation G Army by making a promise to be accepting, be generous, and be kind. Thank you for being here and learning about me and my friends. I love you. Peace out.
Thank you, Gigi. You inspire so many people in the world every day. It's such a pleasure working with you. Today, we're going to talk about How I Learn. How I Learn was created to help us all be better teachers, mentors, professionals, and friends. Now I'm going to show you some simple strategies that make a huge difference when you're teaching people with Down syndrome. One of the first things we want our parents, volunteers, and participants to know is that we see ability and we set expectations high. We will help you reach your highest potential by showing you your best of all every day. Best of all is doing just a little better than you did the day before, and it is always celebrated. That can mean reading one more new word, or practicing five more math problems, or walking that extra block. Challenging yourself to be a little better every day is a great way to improve in all you do. We treat every person with respect, and we always use people-first language. This just means you say the person's name first and then the diagnosis. For example, you might say, Gigi is a person who has Down syndrome.
Good job.
Aw, look at this.
Dog.
Dog.
Good job. Yay.
That's wonderful. You knew that D sound. Does a dog have a tongue hanging out?
No.
We are all unique and we all learn in different ways. We have things we like, things we don't, things that we think are interesting and things that are not. We also have different ways of taking in and storing information. When working with individuals with Down syndrome, it is important to find out what makes them who they are. When we're teaching, we always use a multisensory, multimodal approach. This is just a fancy way to say that we engage all the senses and teach in a variety of ways. Don't be surprised if you walk into a playhouse and find tutors and students engaged in a relay race as they're matching words, or counting steps as they walk across the floor, or finding words in a container full of pasta. Hypotonia, or low muscle tone, is very common for individuals with Down syndrome. Hypotonia affects learning on several levels. It originally impacts movements such as crawling, walking, and balance. It also impacts speech clarity. Did you know it takes around 100 muscles to speak? Did you know reading out loud is exercise for these muscles, and it helps individuals with Down syndrome improve their speech clarity? In general, individuals with Down syndrome need to be stronger before they can accomplish the same tasks as people without Down syndrome. This is one of the reasons we work so hard to incorporate gross and fine motor into all our activities. Learning lifelong fitness for babies to adults is facilitated in our Gigi Fit programs. Gigi Fit was designed by Dr. Sarah Mann specifically to address the unique needs of individuals with Down syndrome.
When I say people,
and the animal say, what will the weather be like today?
Do you have friends with you? Do you have horsies? I have a friend with me. Where's your horsey? I have a shark. Oh, show me how your horsey can run. Ready? We're gonna run. Run, 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 run. Run, 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 run. Good job, horsey. What else can my friend do? Ready? I can jump. Show me your horsey. I have my friend. Make our horsey jump, 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 jump. Good job.
One of the most effective ways to present information is to use visuals and clear instructions. Information that is presented visually stays available for as long as I need to process it. We all use visuals to help us through our day. But for learners with Down syndrome, visuals are essential. Using a visual guide, a schedule, a choice board, or a to-do list allows them to be more independent. Providing structure and predictability helps people know what to expect and for how long. Remember to show more and talk less. Individuals with Down syndrome are often literal learners. They literally learn what we teach them. Remember to be clear and concise with instructions. Literal learners need information presented in a way that promotes errorless learning. Errorless learning is a teaching strategy where the instructions are explicit and concise, and they leave little to no room for mistakes. We make sure that we teach a concept thoroughly before we ask for an answer. This promotes confidence and a healthy learning experience.
Oh, purple.
Good.
Yay! Good job!
Where's the green color? Where's the green color, Savannah?
Which one?
Is this, yeah.
Is this green or is this green?
Wait.
Yes.
Did they go away? How many years ago?
Footprint like a doctor like apple.
That tells us, look, Branson, we can see in the passage that it tells us when they disappeared. It says they disappeared millions of years ago.
Yeah.
That's pretty far.
We use a technique called matching, selecting, and naming that was created by Patricia Olwine when we are teaching whole words in our literacy program. You can see here Yesenia is able to match in a field of three, but if she struggles, we can easily remove one or two of the choices to help ensure she gets the answer correct. This builds her confidence, and the learning then happens so much faster. Notice how this is considered a multi-sensory approach. She is seeing it, she's hearing it, she's touching it, and she's moving it. Breaking things down into small, manageable pieces is really important for our students. Archer and Hughes outlined an approach we use in all our teaching at Gigi's Playhouse. I do, we do, you do. First, we show the student what we're going to do, and then we do it together. First, with hand-over-hand assistance if needed, and move towards less support and independence. You do. We use these phrases to help keep us on track when we are teaching. First, watch me. Now, let's do it together. Can you try it? In this next video clip, notice how Danielle is helping Savannah count using hand-over-hand assistance. And then Savannah tries it on her own. And even though she still needs a little verbal prompting, she's moving towards independent counting.
One, two, three, four.
Yeah!
You
one, one, two, three, one, three,
four,
five, yeah!
You ready? Let's do our dots together. You ready? You count them out. And I'll put mine, you can put yours.
One, two,
excellent.
Three, four, five, six, seven, eight.
Excellent. And now where does it go on the number one?
Oh, I see it. The top.
The top, you're right. Excellent. It goes at the top.
Oh, it's eight and then nine.
You're
When we are teaching reading, we teach using words and examples that are meaningful and relevant to the learner. We adapt all our teaching to incorporate the interests of our participants. You can read about anything. You can count anything. Using our multi-sensory approach, we include movement, games, music, favorite characters from movies or shows, sports, anything that our participants get excited about. The best learning happens when your student is interested and engaged. Watch as Nathan counts purple bears. Earlier in the session, Jen noticed he liked the purple ones because they matched his shirt. Note how she starts by showing him what she wants him to do, and then he starts doing it on his own. She also knows he likes praise and fun, so be sure to notice how he ends his count. Savannah clearly loves animals, so reading about them is a great motivator. If you watch closely, you will see her sign the word elephant.
So, oh my God.
So over it.
Two, three, four,
five.
Stop.
Look at this, Savannah.
Oh,
she's moving up. D, four,
Hat.
Hug.
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 Oh.
Behavior is a form of communication. Sometimes doing something is easier than saying something. Sometimes a person might use a behavior to get out of a situation. They may walk away instead of saying they don't like the situation. They may start to do something else because they don't quite understand the expectations and they don't know how to ask for help. Spend some time getting to know a person so you can start to understand what they are saying with their behavior. Asking for help is an advocacy skill that doesn't come along naturally to everyone. At GG's, we know it is empowering for an individual to ask for help when they need it. Don't always jump right in. Give them the opportunity to figure it out or ask for help.
Six. Now we need one more.
One more.
Six.
Seven.
Eight.
Oh.
Ah.
Ah, it's okay.
Seven.
Seven.
When asking for a response, remember that individuals with Down syndrome have to work harder to retrieve information that is stored. After asking a question, allow time for information to be processed and a response to be generated. Sometimes when I am waiting, I will count silently in my head to remind myself to stay quiet. Repeating the question restarts the process, so limit the amount of times you ask the question. Sometimes you do have to restate the question, but be sure you've given enough time before you do. Visuals can be very helpful here because the person can look at those visuals as long as they need to in order to help them process a response. For example, responding to a written question may be easier than responding to a verbal question. Also, allow time for an internal rehearsal. If you notice that an individual with Down syndrome is engaged in watching, they are likely working out exactly how to perform the action by watching it first, rehearsing it in their minds, and then, with enough practice and confidence, they'll do it.
So what can you tell me about a giraffe now that we just found out? What's something you can tell me, a detail you can tell me about this giraffe?
Yeah.
What about them?
Spots.
They have spots? Anything else you can tell me about it besides spots?
Yeah. It's very tall and long neck.
Very good. Tall and a long neck.
At Gigi's Playhouse, we have designed purposeful programming for all ages with one underlying current, promoting independence. Watch how Sabrina shows her student how to do the Gigi Fit moves by breaking it down into steps and then letting her do it on her own.
Our mission at GG's Playhouse is to change the way the world views Down syndrome and to send a global message of acceptance for all. Our free, purposeful, therapeutic, and educational programs promote independence so that we can show the world that the sky is the limit on what individuals with Down syndrome are truly capable of. Please watch and then share this How I Learn video with friends and colleagues and pass it on.
At Gigi's Playhouse, we see potential. We see ability and possibility. We educate, inspire, and believe. We celebrate uniqueness, and we shout to the world so everyone knows how awesome,
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 awesome
Down syndrome is. We have over 30 playhouses across North America, and more are opening every day. These playhouses are living out our mission and vision, which is to consistently deliver free educational, therapeutic, and career development programs for individuals with Down syndrome, their families, and their communities. We're so excited to share this with you. Gigi's Playhouse promotes independence and learning through free...
Didn't you already say free?
Yes, free! Research-driven, purposeful programs tailored specifically for those living with the extra chromosome. Maybe you know a family member, a classmate, a friend, someone you meet at the supermarket. Maybe you yourself have Down syndrome. We want to share some of our useful tools for learning and communication so you can pass it on.
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 First of all, set expectations high.
Sensory, physical, and psychological differences make us who we are. Knowing more about these things can unlock effective strategies for teaching and learning. They can also help everyone reach their highest potential. Start by always seeing ability first, not disability.
Different make us who we are.
We are all unique and we all learn in different ways. When teaching, engage all the senses.
Say it.
Show it. Read it.
Sing it.
Chop it.
Dance it.
Taste it.
Whisper it.
Tap it.
Sign it.
One of the most effective ways to present information is to use visuals. The pathway from the eyes to the brain is much stronger than the pathway from the ears to the brain.
Use a visual guide, a schedule, a choice board, a to-do list, a rule card. Providing structure and predictability helps people know what to expect and for how long.
Show more, talk less.
Remember to be clear and concise with instructions. Literal learners need information presented in a way that promotes errorless learning. Anticipate any errors that may come up when creating the instruction. Catch and correct mistakes before they're made. You can always go back and reteach if necessary. When it comes to literal learning, we don't always learn from our mistakes. Instead, we learn our mistakes.
Break things down for me.
It's best to take something complex and break it down into small, manageable pieces. You don't make a cake by throwing everything into the pan at once.
It's best to show first and then build confidence and independence. Consider using this approach. First, start by modeling and demonstrating the task for the learner. I do. Then we guide the learner in the task, either with a physical, verbal, or written prompt. We do. The final stage is independence, when the learner can complete the task with little or no prompting. You do. Incorporate interests and find out what motivates each individual and use that. Behavior is a form of communication. Actions speak louder than words and they get more attention.
Sometimes a person might use a behavior to get out of something. And other times they might use that behavior because they don't understand the expectation and they just need a little help.
A little help.
A little, just a little help.
Good.
When looking for a response, remember that individuals with Down syndrome have to work harder to retrieve information that is stored.
I need time, so give me a minute.
Receiving and retrieving information can be tough. Response is the last step in the cycle of communication. It's one we have to not only allow time for, but measure in a different way.
Wait for it.
When learning a new concept, we all go through a rehearsal process. Mirror neurons spark in our brains when we see another person performing an action. Our brains are making all the same connections as if we were doing the same actions we were watching. Allow time for an internal rehearsal. Notice that an individual with Down syndrome is engaged and likely working out how to perform an action by watching it first, rehearsing it in their minds, and then with enough practice and confidence, they'll do it.
I want to be independent.
Our main goal at Gigi's Playhouse is to shift perception and show the world the sky is the limit for people with Down syndrome and what they truly are capable of. The current that guides us is one that constantly promotes independence. With the right learning environment, motivation, and understanding, we can learn, we can work, we can achieve, inspire, and believe. Join us in celebrating our mission and pass it on.
You know, Nancy, I couldn't even blink when you were the movie was going on, and during the movie, I felt my tears coming, running through my face, and that's the truth. You know, you are doing such a great effort and such a great thing that I cannot say how I'm proud and happy to know you. And I can see, you know, I'm pediatric cardiologist just like Dr. Adele, and we are sharing experience with Down syndrome patients. I have too many Down syndrome patients and I love them, you know. I can see what the potential are inside these kids, but they need the facility, they need the energy from their family and from the society to flourish, you know, to they are flowers. I was talking to Dr. Ahmed and I told him I was setting the scene for this sessions about Down syndrome, and all the purpose for this session was to show our colleagues here that Down syndrome is something that they should increase their knowledge about Down syndrome. You know, our scientific knowledge is not enough to deal with Down syndrome. We should deal with them with our heart. We should deal with them with everything we have. You know, I have a Down syndrome patient that every time he come to my clinic, he hugged me, and that's one of the most beautiful hugs that I can get from somebody in this world.
Absolutely. I truly believe, and thank you so much for that. I truly believe that our kids were sent here to teach and to love. Yeah. And that is their purpose. That is why they are here. And we just have to give them those tools. You know, they wear that diagnosis on their face. So instantly people know what's going on and they think they don't have that potential. But you're exactly right. When you empower them, when you give them the tools, when you praise them, they will do anything for you. There's nothing that they can't do. We have a 58-year-old at one of our locations who just started learning to read for the first time at 58 years old. And he wrote a book. It's a book about him and how healthy it is for him to be walking. He's in Gigi Fit now too. So he wrote a book about what he's doing in his life and how it helps him, and how the GGU philosophy, confident you, healthy you, whole you, is the most important thing for all of us. This isn't just for Down syndrome, you know, it's one part nutrition, one part information, and one part fitness, growing ourselves from the inside out. And think about how much that helps us as individuals and how much more productive we are. Now think about these guys when they carry that weight of low muscle tone. That's hard. That is a big load to carry every day of your life. And how do they carry it? With a smile on their face, with wanting to help others and do more. So if we can help them by getting them in good physical fit, you know, good shape with Gigi Fit, or, you know, through their doctors, motivating them and telling them how much more will help, that, think how much better their lives are going to be. And that's what our programming is all about, really getting them, empowering them. But also, you guys, we have to empower their families, and that, you know, their families, they can do what they can do. But if their families aren't going to assist them or help them, that makes it much harder. So a lot of the things that we do, we try to teach that independence, because you're not always going to have your parents there helping you, or a sibling, or somebody who's going to be there. We got to get these guys because they have the capacity and they have the potential. They just need people to believe. And that belief starts at birth. You know, the sooner, Nancy, people believe, the stronger they will be.
Nancy, there are too many topics that before the session I have received from my colleagues and also from the families, and I want to hold some of our time for discussion about this topic. So if Mariam, if we can go to the last speaker and then we will come back to our discussion. Thank you very much.
See, that's exactly why I made a video. Now you know.
Okay, I have to thank you, Nancy, as well, Nancy, Sherry, and also Danielle for all the help that you guys helped us and to arrange this and to for the amazing video, because, you know, this is just the beginning. This, let's just shout it that this is just the beginning. We recently heard, yes. Actually, I may not just say this, but in an academic place, but you know, we just heard about the first Victoria's Secret model who is a Down syndrome. You know, yes. This is just the beginning.
Absolutely.
And, you know, there are the possibilities for these people, for these beautiful people, for these beautiful heart are endless. And your talk was inspiring. Danita's talk was inspiring. And I'm pretty sure that Tehmina, who has joined us, I know you were really busy. And thank you for joining us. And I'm pretty sure that the whole talk and this whole session is going to wrap and is going to be a celebration of these people, of these beautiful souls. So thank again for the beautiful video that you guys, Sherry, Danielle, and also especially Nancy, for the beautiful video that you sent us. And with this, we are going to go to dear Tahmina. So hi, Tahmina, thanks for joining us despite your busy schedule. Thank you. I was really worried that you would not be able to join us.
Yeah, I know.
But thank you for joining us. So before you start, let me start by introducing you to our dear audiences. So just a minute. Okay. So dear Tahmina Hakimova is a proud mother of Safraz, a 9-year-old boy with Down syndrome. She lives in London, but is originally from Tajikistan. She's a gender and diversity expert and has over 12 years of international experience in gender and inclusion issues. She's also a founder and chair of trustees of the UK-based charity Nazari Digar, which supports people with Down syndrome in Tajikistan and Central Asia region. She's also a founder and activist of the movement on the rights of people with Down syndrome in Tajikistan called Nazari Digar, which is in Farsi and also meaning different view. So Tahmina, it's really great to see you with us today. Thank you. And the stage is yours.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you, first of all, for Dr. Ahmed to finding me and inviting. And it's especially a pleasure for me being a Tajik. And basically, Iran and us, we have the same culture, you know,
yeah.
And the same language we speak. So it's really an honor for me to participate. And I'm always for talking about Down syndrome. And I can talk for a long time. So you asked me to record the presentation for 20 minutes, yeah. 35. So I really want you to sort of give me some kind of timings, because when I talk mm-hmm. about Down syndrome and Nazari Digar, I can talk for hours.
Yeah. Okay. So I'm guessing that we're going to have about 25 to maximum of 30 minutes for you to inspire us.
Yes, but can you open my presentation, because I want
yes.
to share.
Yeah. I can share the video that you just sent me. So do you want me to do that?
No, I sent you also the presentation separately.
I just received two recordings of your speech, your talk. I didn't receive any presentations.
Can you give me the permission to share my screen?
Yeah, of course. You have a permission actually right now, and you can All share right. your screen.
It says host disabled participants screen.
Yeah, wait a minute. Where are you? Oh my God. This is my bad. I'm really sorry. You can share your screen now.
Great. Let me just open it. So let me get this beautiful
oh my God.
Nice face. So you can see. So first of all, I just wanted to introduce myself very briefly. Thank you for a really nice introduction. But the main thing for me is this, I'm a proud Tajik, even though I live in the UK for the last 12 years, but I'm a proud patriot of my country. And I'm a proud mother of a son who has Down syndrome. Well, first of all, his name, yeah? People with Down syndrome, it's not, you know, Down syndrome does not describe him or identify him. He is Saphros. So Saphros is, the translation is a blessing. So, so Saphros turned just 10 2 days ago. And so I just wanted to say, well, I think I'll talk about it further, but just to say Hidden Sunbeams of Tajikistan, that keep this in mind. I'll explain why the name of my presentation and my first actually photo exhibition of children with Down syndrome was named like this. I just wanted to say a little bit about Nazar-e Digar and then sort of how it was founded. And then I'll talk more about our activities and our very important research that we have done. So Nazar-e Digar is a different view. In Farsi or in Persian or, you know, Tajik, it means different view. So the name I was looking for, you know, for a long time, how to name this initiative. First, it was my initiative. Now it's a charity. So I want to see people with Down syndrome in Tajikistan to be looked at in a positive way. And, you know, it was a different view, like Nazar-e Digar, more kind way. And I want more acceptance of them in the society. So that's why it's, the name of it is Nazar-e Digar. So it was founded back in 2019 as my, you know, initiative. I just did my first fundraising initiative in my life for my birthday anniversary. That's what I liked in the UK, what people were doing. They do something, they choose a charity or the cause and do something. So I wanted to do something for people with Down syndrome in my country. But what struck me after I had my child, I have nobody in my family who had Down syndrome. And I didn't, my husband doesn't have anybody with Down syndrome in his family. And what struck me was that I basically haven't seen people with Down syndrome you know, in Tajikistan growing up, which was like a warning sign, because of course there are people with Down syndrome in my country, they're everywhere. But that's why the name of my presentation and my photo exhibition was The Hidden Sunbeams of Tajikistan, because these beautiful people were just hidden for two reasons, from what I understood, you know, during these 3 years that of my personal interaction with the families. That the one of the reasons is because society does not accept people with Down syndrome, and unfortunately they tease them. They, you know, little kids throw stones. They're very not nice to them, and that's why you know, that's why the parents want to give safety to their children. They just keep them in their house. But the second reason is that the embarrassment and shame on the family, or the family puts on themselves, or especially mothers blaming themselves for giving a birth for this child. We'll talk about it later. And that's why there is these two sides of why they're hidden. And so this initiative, I did a photo exhibition. So I was looking for people with children with Down syndrome all over the country. At that moment, I found about 10 of them, and I took pictures of them. And then I did, you know, the photo exhibition at a special place, Langdon Down Center. Langdon Down is a doctor who, after whom, you know, Down syndrome is named. So there's a historic place here where I did my photo exhibition. And I, to my surprise, and especially my husband's, who said that I'll never get £5,000, I doubled it. So I fundraised £10,000. And it's a big amount of money for Tajikistan. And that's why I went back and this all started. with 10 parents, 15 parents. Now we have more than 200 parents the charity supports. And we had to register because it was expanding and we had to register. So we have a charity or a public organization or NGO in Tajikistan registered. And we also have, UK-based charity called Nazarigar United Kingdom. So our role is basically to fundraise and get money for this small charity in Tajikistan. I said this. So basically, I just wanted to briefly say about this very important research that we have done among 100 parents of children with Down syndrome from all the regions of Tajikistan and Dushanbe, the capital. This is the first research, and what we wanted to know, how and when the diagnosis of a child is presented to the parents, how parents make the decision, what and on who impacts or influences their decision further. And we just wanted to see the parents' view about inclusion. How do they see it? Does it exist in our society? We did this research because from what we were our interactions, we could see that obviously it's not a good situation. And that's why we wanted to get the facts from these parents to further lobby the government and advocate for the changes in the society. This is our next steps. So this is the beautiful child who comes to our center in Hujan. Oops. Just wanted to show you the quote. Not going to read it, but just the quote from one of the parents, which shows that it's one of the rural areas in Tajikistan. And it shows that even the ultrasound people who do the first scan, especially in rural areas, they're not educated well enough. They even give these wrong things. They said to the mother that your child doesn't have legs or arms and she was just happy to have a child with legs and arms when she had a child. She didn't care about whatever diagnoses are. But I think this is really scary. This is really something serious that the government needs to do, educating these people, because it gives so much stress. This mom was saying she was crying day and night, thinking her child doesn't have legs and arms. I just wanted to say that also prenatally, they do not screen. There is no proper screening process in Tajikistan because of lack of proper equipment and chemicals that are needed for the lab to see. And in the rural areas, none of them were told before, or even when they gave birth in the maternity house. But in the bigger cities, there was bigger problems. These are the pictures from some of the photo exhibition, actually. So also another worrying sign was that, what did the doctor say? So unfortunately, we saw that the doctors do not say any positive things about children with Down syndrome, or it's not just doctors, it's also like the medical personnel who are in the maternity house. Basically, they just say that their view is completely incorrect and outdated about Down syndrome. They put the blame on the poor mother, and they say, I even was in a talk show with some genetics people, and I had basically massive arguments on TV with them, giving proof that their view is completely Soviet and outdated. They basically say that if the mother has a flu, if mother has even, smokes, drinks, does smoking, drinking doesn't happen among those mothers who are, it's an Islamic country. So, and any kind of really silly things, and just putting a blame on a mother. Another thing that we saw that what they were basically saying, nothing positive, but just saying the child can't walk, can't talk, won't understand you, complete fool, you know, and all these, and also in a really rude way, you know, I put it down in a more nicer way here, but it's a very negative way. And I also, recommendations from doctors, this is the worrying sign, especially, because in the bigger cities, in Khojand, in Dushanbe, Khojand is my home country, hometown, they were basically saying to reject the child. They, when a child with Down syndrome is born, they just say, you need to reject your child because this is why you need this burden. It's better for this child to be in an orphanage and things like that, which is really, yeah, it's mean. And then another thing that was very frustrating to hear, it was that the injection. So not again, you know, not when I'm talking about injection, I just wanted to say that I don't want to generalize all the doctors. It's just few doctors, we even have the names of them, obviously it's confidential, but few doctors in some town and that's hospitals, they suggest the parents to do the injection, meaning killing the child. The injection kills the child. And even now, their children are like 20 years old, 15 years old. When we interviewed, they were just crying. It's like remembering that the doctors suggested to kill my child. It's just, it's against, legally, it's a crime in Tajikistan to do that. It's illegal. And also in our, you know, Islamic view, it's just, you don't, it's even more important, yeah? You don't do things like that. So this is the sort of horrific facts that we found and proved now. This is my son, by the way, Safroz. He's 10 now, but when he was, he's going through his behavioral challenges now, but here he's so sweet. I want him back like this. Sweet and kind child. But this is one of the quotes. So it says, I really want to go, you know, to the doctor, most of the parents, and just show my child proudly and say that here you go, he's walking, he's talking, he loves me, he's beautiful. And you know, this is the sort of the thing. Let's see. And so decision, so it was also so decision of parents and what impacts or influence them is obviously the words of this not very nice professional doctors influence them, because in Tajikistan, you know, parents blindly believe the doctors. Doctors are like gods, you know, they just believe them and trust them, especially in the things they don't understand health-wise. They have no idea. We all parents didn't know anything about Down syndrome before. And then they, you know, the divorce rate is high because the woman is blamed for that. Also the I'm a gender specialist, so I mean professionally I could see that the rate of domestic violence is very high in Tajikistan anyway, but for these women there is even more, you know, double or triple discrimination because of giving a birth to this child and giving, you know, blame on them. And then, you know, the rate of physical violence, psychological violence is very, very extremely high. Not just from also husband, but if they leave the family, mothers-in-law, you know, like sisters-in-law, etc. Blame I spoke about, but also when you don't know anything about Down syndrome and you give a birth to a little baby with Down syndrome, and then when they say about all this negative stuff about your baby not able to do anything, then there was a very big disbelief in abilities of their child for parents also, like thinking that, yeah, so he can't walk, he can't do this, so I shouldn't develop my child. But also like they don't know how to do it. That's why most of the, what do you say? Say hello. You say hello to my friends?
Hi.
Hi.
Hi. Rose. Hi, sweetie. Hi.
So basically, okay, Saf, I need to. So, so basically, because they didn't develop and they didn't know how to help their children, there are 20-year-olds with Down syndrome, 30, even 40, that do not, they're nonverbal. They're not, they don't talk, you know, because of this. Obviously, depression levels are quite high. And, you know, unfortunately, it's not very high, but still there is this abandonment of their child. They listen to the doctors or medical personnel and leave their child in the orphanage. I was involved in four of these conversations with parents, with one who officially rejected. And then, you know, after I spoke to both parents and then my team, they took the child. Her name is Amina. I'll talk about her a bit later. And but she died after 3 months, but at least she was with her parents at least these 3 months. This is also another thing about inclusion. I didn't want to talk much about inclusion because there is no inclusion in Tajik society, basically. That's what this quote of the parent really struck me when she says that, you know, now with all our organization, other charities, we try to get our children into mainstream school because they go to closed institutions, you know, they're hidden again from society and from schools. Our children, we try and fight to get them into the mainstream school, but in the mainstream school, there are 30, 40 children, and there is no teaching assistant to, or, you know, who will look after your child and help your child in this way. And then also no acceptance, you know, and all this mistreatment and things. That's why she's saying, why do we fight for this? First, we need to have proper, you know, services there and then work on inclusion. And then we need to think about getting our children to the safe place. So the findings of the research just, you know, it shows that the discrimination of people with Down syndrome is very high in Tajikistan. And, you know, as we said, there are no medical ethics among doctors or medical personnel when they present the diagnosis. And it's absolutely incorrect and outdated. And also this is the same. So, and also this all shows, we are starting our advocacy now and we're just showing with the little short interviews of parents videos, they're showing that actually what you're doing is a violation of the right to family according to the Constitution of the Republic of Tajikistan, international conventions and other laws that, you know, violation of right to family, violation, you know, the right to life and inclusion, proper medical service. And yeah, we could see that the impact of the words of the medical personnel is very high in these families. Also, one of the things that really struck me was that there is no... you cannot diagnose or confirm the diagnosis Down syndrome in Tajikistan medically. There is no equipment and there is no all these some kind of chemicals, I don't know in English what you call them, in order to do the blood test to confirm the diagnosis. And can you imagine this? It's, there are children, they're born and in the next 5 minutes, they're told, their parents told, your child has Down syndrome, not might have, your child has Down syndrome because they see some features. But we are Tajiks, you know, our eyes can be also almond shape. There are so many cases. I saw also some of the children. I was like, I don't think your child has Down syndrome because, you know, when you talk, when you see, you know, and that got confirmed when some really good doctors from Uzbekistan came. They told to the mother, your child does not have Down syndrome. And the mother for 11 years thinks that this child has Down syndrome. So there are cases like this, also some who could afford, some parents who can afford to go to Russia or to like Uzbekistan, they do the blood test and they see that actually their child does not have Down syndrome. So it's all a big mess. So that was briefly about our report, but a little bit about more positive things that we've done, I think now. So one of the biggest things for me was when I just came to the country and I was interacting with parents. The children with Down syndrome don't have any annual routine medical checks or any kind of routine checks. Seeing the cardiologist, checking thyroid levels, vision and hearing is four main things that you need to do to check your child. There might be some other things, but these are the main things that annually needs to be checked, especially in the beginning. And so these parents, most of them just checked the heart, but also like the first year, but then they never checked it. So I thought that the very important thing for us is to do the medical checks. So for the first time, they were having medical checks, like cardiologist, thyroid levels, the blood tests, and the vision and the hearing. So what we did, we have really nice cardiologists, really like one of the number three really good ones in Khujan, in northern Tajikistan. He works in a government clinic. So we got the permission from the government and now for free, there are, for so many days or 1 week, these 200 kids from all rural areas everywhere can come and for free get checked by the really good cardiologist. And so every April for 3 years, we're doing it. And then thyroid levels, we just got some discounts, but we fundraised to get the money to do this blood test, but we checked that as well. And then they see the endocrinologist and we checked the vision. Can you imagine never their vision was checked? And there were so many kids that were almost like blind and that, the parents didn't know. And we also got them some frames because if you know the children with Down syndrome, they don't have this little sort of bone here. So it's a little bit different, yeah. Their noses. And then the sort of the classical, these frames, they might hurt them or it might fall. That's why they're special ones. So what I do, we get it from the UK, like even used ones, recycle them. We send them to Tajikistan, give it to these children. The only thing we couldn't do is hearing. To my surprise, it's a very big region in Tajikistan, the northern part of Tajikistan, when we especially work. There is no hearing equipment for children, any children, to check properly, unfortunately. So maybe one day we will fundraise for this equipment and make sure that we check their hearing. So this is what we do. And then there is this medical card in the UK when a child with Down syndrome is born, there is this red card, children's card, every child gets it. And inside the card for my son, I had a special attachment, which was like for the boys with Down syndrome, all these milestones, all these things, it's compared to other children with Down syndrome. When you put the percentile, but not to other sort of kids, because you shouldn't compare them to other kids. So I think that's also in this medical card, in this attachment, there is this also the schedule of routine checks that we need to do, a reminder for parents to do this. So that was really helpful because I didn't know anything about Down syndrome like those parents in Tajikistan, but I'm just lucky to give a birth to my child in this country, in developed country, which actually took care of me and my child. So this is what I want to see in my country, and we're slowly going there. I just wanted to tell you about this really nice initiative that we had in Tajikistan. It's called Nuri Amina, or the light of Amina, or Amina's sunbeam, or Luch Amina in Russian. So this little Amina, when she was born, the doctor in the rural area, the doctors just basically forced the parents to leave, reject the child. Mom was under psychological thing. She didn't want to do it, but they convinced the dad. Anyway, they left the child officially. And I spoke to both parents and then my team, and then they finally got the child back. But after 3 months, she died. 3-4 months, she died. So because we were so interfered with her life, and she personally to me showed through what things these little babies go, I feel like, you know, I talked to her mom also, her, you know, her soul, her spirit had a big meaning being in this world, even for 3-4 months. She showed what difficulties and challenges they go through from the moment they're born in this country. And we named this Nuri like Amina Sunbeam. And what we did, we had these boxes for newborns with Down syndrome that we now, they're everywhere in Tajikistan now. But what it did, it's really beautiful initiative, because it's these boxes are made by 5 adults with Down syndrome who otherwise would not be employed at all. So we employed them. We taught them how to do these boxes. They did an excellent job. And they put all the sort of little clothes. Also, we had a whole nationwide campaign in terms of women who knit. We said, if you want to knit for these little babies with Down syndrome, we can do this. And, you know, people were very kind, even from America, from everywhere, Tajiks were sending knitted clothes. So we put the clothes in the boxes, and the boxes, and we put some. Also, the most important thing is, I'm talking so fast. Okay. And then we would basically put some information there. I think the most important thing is that. Big, lots of information saying congratulations with the birth of your child, and all the medical aspects, other aspects, like in a really nice way, correct way, is put. It's basically the information booklet, big one from Down Syndrome Association UK. So they gave us the permission to translate it into Tajik and Russian. But also through these boxes, we started our cooperation with the maternity houses. So now we're sort of changing things, because the maternity houses say bad things about our children. Now we're preventing these things. Now they're cooperating with us, raising their awareness about Down syndrome. When the child is born, giving our contacts, and our psychologists give the support to parents. And now things are changing, which is really good. And I just wanted to show you our adults actually doing it on a very short video.
Oh, dear Tahmina, we don't have the video. I think it has opened in another window, and you've just shared your PowerPoint window with us. So maybe you should stop your screen share and then share the whole screen with us. Because we could see your slides.
Yeah. Can you see now?
Yes.
Thank you for letting me know that. There you go. Look how with so much love they're doing it. Can this is my hometown, this is Fujian. They're now taking the boxes to the maternity house. That's how it happens usually. So that we prefer adults with Down syndrome taking it so the parents can meet them as well. So this is the maternity house, number one in the city. Wow. I think I need to stop this, and now and get my presentation back.
Yeah, your Tamina, it was really beautiful. Just sorry that I just have to mention the time limit that we have. Although we are really enjoying your time, your speech, but just have in mind our time limits as well.
Is it my time finished or what?
It's a little bit past your time, but we can have 5 more minutes for your talk.
In this case, I'm not going to read these recommendations. It's sort of like, I just wanted, it's better for you to see this video, I think. So let me open this and it's going to sort of finish. Let's stop this. Get subtitles. Trying to get this up so you can see, but
man ish hasta.
Wow.
I'm mostly enjoying the reaction of your boy.
You know, some of the children, you see their faces, that's why he's excited. I think that's all. Sorry that I went. I told you I can talk for a very long time. But thank you so much for your attention.
Tamina, it was a pleasure knowing you, and we do really enjoy what you have to say. And you know, the cultures, the language is the same. So we are sharing some problems that can be the same. You know, we are living in the same region with the same culture. So what you were talking about was something that you can find in some regions in our country too, with some little differences, but we can see what you are talking about, you know. So I can feel what you have done from abroad for your country was a great success, you know. That is great success. I can feel that, and I can see the bright future for your people because they have you. That is a great success. I should congratulate you for what you have done for your people.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Again, Tahmina, I wanted to thank you for this amazing talk that you gave us. As Dr. Aghaei said, the cultural aspects that you were saying, we have the similar, not exactly the same, but we have the similar problems and we have the similar issues in our culture as well. So it was really interesting to listen to this and to see that the same is happening there and what you are doing and to get inspiration. You know, this is the reason that we're having this session, to get inspired, everyone from all around the world, whoever is watching this, to inspire, to learn and to listen that who other people, whom is doing what in their region, what can we do, and let's learn and and let's just start this talk. Let's just start this movement and this through this amazing road. So I have to say that the spotlight for I have to say that the photos that were you shared during your slides, they were really beautiful. They were really beautiful. So thank you. And I have to say that the spotlight for me in your slides and also the Nancy slides were, you know, in Nancy's, it was the Gigi's presence. It was when Gigi was started to talking with her hard attitude with a leather jacket and I am Gigi and I'm great, you know, and that was really great. And also for you, Tahmina, for sharing the pictures of your beautiful son and also especially your son walking and going, and then in the video part he was saying, wow, you know, this was the spotlight of this presentation for me, just seeing this interaction and how these boys and how these children are evolving and how they're flourishing in this environment. So this is really amazing. So thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you, Nancy. Thank you, Tahmina. Thank you, Danita. Thank you, Sherry. Thanks, everyone. And also a special thanks, Dr. Ahmad, for arranging this amazing, amazing meeting. So I just have a question, actually, myself, as a pediatrician. I really wanted to ask you guys, as the mothers of the Down syndrome patients, you know, how do you prefer us pediatricians to tell you the news? So, for example, in prenatal exam or maybe in after, when, for example, in some regions that they do not have prenatal diagnosis, so when the child is born, they make this diagnosis. So how do you like us to give you this news? How do you prefer this? Tahmina, Nancy, or Danita, if you have any insight.
Yeah, I can say I was told about the diagnosis really, really in a professional way here in the UK. I knew that they call it risk, I call it chance, yeah? The chance of having a child with Down syndrome was extremely high, 1 in 35. Now I understand how high it is learning more about Down syndrome. It was my first child. And also they said it's, you know, they did the screenings at 1 in 35 and Down syndrome, like, what is Down syndrome, you know? Yeah, and then it was very stressful to I mean, the decision one, I'm not aborting my child. This is like against my faith, my just my values and everything else. And you know, but it was very difficult in terms of I had the indirect pressure from some medical nurses, not doctors. Doctors were extremely professional in the UK, but nurses were like putting a little bit pressure on me every time I would go. They said, because I said, I'm not doing amniocentesis to find out, because that's interference into the natural thing, you know, and there is 1% of miscarriage. And if I miscarry out of my curiosity, I cannot leave further, you know, if something happens to this child. And but that indirect pressure was, oh my God, do you know you have a high risk? Do you know you have a high risk every time? So obviously we decided to, you know, whoever is given to us, given. But then it was extremely difficult when it was confirmed anyway. But what, you know, how, what I liked about how it was given, was given in a positive way, but not like, you know, super made up way. It's like with some facts, but positive facts from Down Syndrome Association. They had the booklets from them, and they had the same things we're giving now to parents in Tajikistan. That was extremely helpful. They said in nice professional ways about Down Syndrome, they referred us to this charity, and that's what we did. We went with Safros. I don't think that I personally, as a mother, want to hear beautiful stories or a little bit lies just to make it like, oh, it's going to be all perfect, great, you'll be fine. But yeah, you can do this. You can make it. This is good. I like this sort of, you know, you're strong. But in terms of like, I just wanted the facts, and that's what I liked. Sort of, I don't know, maybe.
Yeah, and for me, I didn't find out till after Gigi was born. And what I found really disturbing was that they came to me instead of, and again, they took such good care of me medically. But to them, they even told me on Monday when I was leaving, they were like, whew, you guys really shook this place up this weekend. Like, if this can happen to you, it can happen to anyone. And I'm like, what is this? Like, what does that mean? And I was like, you know, the nurses who took such good care of me, they didn't have eye contact with me after that. We came in as being the cool, fun parents. We brought food for everybody. And then all of a sudden that kind of changed. Like they didn't really want to engage as much because I felt like for them that they knew that life as I knew it was over, but it didn't mean that that was going to be a bad life. You know, I wish I didn't, you know, and we were told all of the things that could happen. You know, when a typical baby's born, you don't say your baby might have ADD. They might get juvenile diabetes. They could get cancer. You know what? They might get that. But when you have a child with Down syndrome, you kind of hear about all these other things that can happen. And you know what? Maybe they will, but maybe they won't. And that's why I have an amazing doctor to help me. So I think giving that laundry list of things that could go wrong, instead of just saying, you know what, you've got yourself a beautiful little girl that is going to need some extra help, but will be amazing. And we'll bring true, you know, gifts to your family. It's not going to be easy, but raising what kid is easy? And I think that just kind of having that honesty with it, but not painting that bleak picture. I mean, they literally sent in every clergyman you could think of. I prayed with, I was like, oh, here comes another one. They just kept sending in the clergy. And then I'm like, is she dying? Like, what do I not know? What's happening? So that was, I think by just being, you know, honest about, you know, we know what this diagnosis is. There is going to be muscle tone. She's going to need some extra help. She's going to need that. But you're, you know, there's places, you know, like a Gigi's or like with a DSA or whatever, where you can get those tools. But I think not to give that laundry list of things that could go wrong and let them go home and enjoy their baby, because the sooner they accept that diagnosis, the better life that child's going to have. But how do you accept something that sounds so negative, that is just constantly, you know, there's so much negativity surrounded by it. And I just want to let you guys know too, in the US, it's so interesting when you were talking about them saying that baby wouldn't have arms and legs. We just had a mom come in, actually it was right before COVID. So not just came in, it was right before COVID when babies were coming in. And she had been told that her baby was going to be born with no nose and her intestines on the outside of her body. And 2 months later, and that she needed to terminate that pregnancy. And 2 months later, she had a perfectly beautiful baby with a button nose and intestines intact where they were supposed to be. But when you said that, it was just interesting because I think a lot of times it's, you know, it's what people know about Down syndrome and they think we shouldn't bring those kids into the world, you know, because when, you know, I think I've heard, I don't know, because I'm not a doctor, but that in medical school, you don't learn a lot about Down syndrome. So, and when you see our kids, you got to think about this. When you guys see our kids, it's when they're sick. You don't see them at their best. You don't see them, you know, Gigi sang the national anthem at a Chicago Cubs game and a White Sox game. You don't see them when they're out doing great things. You see them when they're sick and miserable, you know? So of course we understand why you have that perception, because you know, textbook Down syndrome, which is not pretty. So we just want to show you the other side. That's what I think, that's my take. Sherry, I know you had a prenatal diagnosis, so yours was different than me. And
I did have a prenatal diagnosis, so I knew that Heather was going to have Down syndrome when she was born. And so I heard that whole big laundry list of all of the things that she was probably going to have. And so I was convinced that I was having a big ball of Down syndrome, and I was so surprised when I had a baby. I was like, is she just a baby? Like, it was so funny. I just really thought that. But then I had the same experience with the staff at the hospital. No one would look at me and no one would talk to me. And so finally I grabbed one nurse when she went by and I said, do these people know my baby has Down syndrome? Like, is there something we should be doing? Like, what do we do? And she's like, oh, they know. And then she walked away. That was the extent of, you know, it was, and then I was just kind of on my own after that.
Anita.
You know, the experience of having a Down syndrome baby is hard for the family and also for the physician. I have encountered so many mothers that I should tell them that the baby has Down syndrome, and I, as a physician, I didn't know how to tell the family because the period of denial that they are going through is so hard. For example, the father knows that the baby has the problem, but mother does not know that. So it is very difficult. And I think there should be educational courses for the physicians to get familiar, not only for giving the news about Down syndrome, but also the other syndromes. For example, we have too many patients with DiGeorge syndrome, that it is also something with some difficulties, some different types of difficulties from Down syndrome, but that is also a syndrome with some learning difficulties and cardiac problems and so on. There are so many questions, and I think we cannot have all of them in this session, but I can say we were planning with Ahmed, with Dr. Ahmed, for another session for Down syndrome with different subspecialities. For example, we shall have psychologists for and adult cardiologists to discuss some problems after teenage, you know.
Yes.
And I want to invite you to that session, and we can discuss some more problems and some more issues with these patients in that session. If I can invite you, can you give us your valuable time for that session too?
Love to. I think this is how change happens, you guys. It's everybody getting together, and because I'm on the front lines, I see it every day with 55 locations and all over the, now serving families in 81 countries. So many different issues that are going on, and that adult population, there's a big piece there. And with our kids living longer, I would love to be involved in that, and I would love to see us make more strides in many of the places you talked about. And if we could get there together, that
and
nothing
also,
would make me happier.
For the last question, I want to ask you, Nancy, that one of my colleagues asked, do you have any publications that it is so simple for the families to know, and also for physicians, to know how to deal with the families of Down syndrome? Do you have any publications that you can share with us?
Hi, Jeej. I don't have any, sorry, she's popped her head in. Sherry, that might be a better question for you, but I do think that there is the resources that are there now, like for the hospitals, like that a doctor would be using, you know, that I didn't find helpful as a new mother. So Sherry, there might be something, or we could look into it and get back to you guys, because there's different things. There's so many different publications that are out there, but I would love to find the right one, you guys, because I feel like there's a lot of them out there that aren't necessarily the right one. You know what I mean?
You know, I can see what you're telling me, and if you can find us some this is the favor to ask from all. Hi.
Hello.
Hi.
Oh, big. How old is she? How old are you?
I'm 19.
How old?
13.
19.
Oh, my God. Big girl.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah, she's hosting a gala this weekend on her own, aren't you?
Yes.
Yes, she is. Wow. Get out there and go practice. I will. All right. Say goodbye.
Good girl.
And one of the other topics that we shall discuss in future is how to get the patients with Down syndrome into the career, you know, into a job, and how can we get jobs that fits their abilities. This is a question that frequently asked from the families, and what can they do in future? Let us do not close the discussion, and let it for the next session together. And we shall have you with our new colleagues. And so let's go back to Maria.
Okay, so I totally agree with you, dear professor, because I believe that this is just, as I said, this is just the beginning, and we should keep this talk going, and we should keep talking about it with more people, with different societies, with different organizations, with different pediatricians and other adult cardiologists or adult endocrinologists. And there is a lot to talk about. So I'm pretty sure that we're going to have an amazing talk in the future. I can't thank you enough, all of you, for giving us your time, for joining us, dear Nancy, dear Tahmina, dear Danita, Sherry, Danielle. So I can't thank you enough. And dear Professor Ahmad, thanks again.
Yes.
Thanks again for arranging these two amazing sessions for today. And we can't thank you. We hope you, please stay safe during COVID days, but we hope to see you here one day in Iran in COVID-free days. You're more than welcome. And all of you guys, and please take care and have a great day. And send our regards to your beautiful children, especially Gigi.
Absolutely. And your, yes.
Yeah.
Thank you, everyone.
Okay, have a great day.
This is how change happens. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Bye, guys.
Congratulations. Congratulations, Mariam, for visiting us.
Bye, Nancy.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.
Bye, Tamina.
Bye.
Bye, guys.